Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and welcome back to this next video. And in this particular video, I want to focus on the molecular basis of cancer. I'll be talking about the proto-oncogenes, the tumor suppressor genes, and the oncogenes. And this is the fifth video in the series of videos on the cancer. In the last video, I've told you about the carcinogens and the co-carcinogens. That the carcinogen, they are actually the agents that has the capacity to cause cancer in humans without the help of any other thing. While the co-carcinogen, they are actually the chemical or agents that they do not have the ability to cause cancer on their own. But what they actually do is that they promote the effect of the carcinogen in the production of cancer. I have a detailed video on this, and I'll share the link in the description. In this particular video, I want to focus on the proto-oncogenes, the tumor suppressor genes, and the oncogenes. So the first thing we are going to discuss is the proto-oncogene. Now, this proto-oncogene, if you define this, a proto-oncogene is a normal gene that can become an oncogene due to mutation or increased expression. This means that these proto-oncogenes, they are the normal part of the cell. They are the they are required for the normal cell division and the normal cell growth. But when there are mutations in these proto-oncogenes, the resultant gene is known as the oncogene. And when the proto-oncogene is converted into the oncogene, it actually loses its ability for the normal cell growth and differentiation. And there is abnormal cell growth and differentiation, which is actually a sign of the cancer. Now, when the proto-oncogene that is converted into an oncogene due to mutation, the resultant protein that is sometimes known as the oncoprotein. What these proto-oncogenes normally do in the cell is that they are required to help regulate the cell growth and differentiation, and they are very much important, and they are involved in the signal transduction and the execution of the mitogenic signals through their protein product. One of the important examples of this proto-oncogene that I'm going to give you is the complex of the cyclin D1 and the CDK4 and CDC6. And in this particular complex, this CDK4 or this CDK6, this is a proto-oncogene. Now, what normally happens is that when there is an extracellular signal in the form of the growth factor, and when there are growth factors, that means that you can go for the cell division, as the environment for the cell division is optimum, or that is there. What happens is that when there is an extracellular signal in the form of the growth factors, the CDK4 or 6 that combines with the cyclin D, and the complex of the cyclin D and the CDK4 and 6 is known as the G1 CDK. What this G1 CDK do is that it is going for the phosphorylation of an important protein, which is known as the retinoblastoma protein. As you can see over here, that when the complex of the cyclin D and the CDK4/6 that act on the retinoblastoma protein, it is going to get it phosphorylated. Now, why we need the phosphorylation of the retinoblastoma protein? The reason is that when the retinoblastoma protein is non-phosphorylated, in a non-phosphorylated form, it is in interaction with another protein, which is known as the E2F. And this E2F is an important transcription factor in the S phase of the cell cycle. So if you want to move from the G1 into the S phase of the cell cycle, you have to release the E2F from the retinoblastoma protein. And one of the ways you can release the E2F from the retinoblastoma protein is the phosphorylation of the retinoblastoma protein. So if I summarize the whole thing, when there is signal for growth, you have to move from the G1 into the S phase, you have to move from the S into the G2 into the M, and hence you will go for the cell division. So what happens is, when the extracellular signal comes, the CDK4/6, it combined with the cyclin D, this complex is going for the phosphorylation of the retinoblastoma protein. And when the retinoblastoma protein is phosphorylated, the E2F will be released. You can actually move from the G1 into the S phase of the cell cycle. This is what is normally happening. Now, if there is mutation in this proto-oncogene in the CDK4 or 6, as you can see over here, so if there is a mutation over here, and if it combines with the cyclin D, even in the absence of the extracellular signals, that means it will be wrongly signaling the cell for the cell division. And if it is wrongly signaling the cell for the cell division, that means there will be cancer. So when the CDK4/6 due to mutation, it is converted into an oncogene, it can be responsible for causing cancer. The other important examples of the proto-oncogene that include the RAS protein, the ERK protein, and the MYC protein. If you look at this MYC protein, this MYC gene or the MYC protein, it is normally implicated in the Burkitt's lymphoma. And this Burkitt lymphoma simply is a form of the non-Hodgkin lymphoma of the B cells. Now, what happens during this Burkitt lymphoma is that there is a chromosomal translocation, and during this chromosomal translocation, an enhancer sequence is wrongly placed within the vicinity of the MYC gene. So this MYC gene is the normal gene which is required for the normal functioning and the division of the B cell, but due to the wrong placement of the enhancer sequence because of the chromosomal translocation in the vicinity of the MYC gene it is converted into an oncogene. Now this MYC gene, it codes for a variety of the transcription factors, and when the enhancer sequence is wrongly placed, these transcription factors are produced at much higher rates, and when they are produced at much higher rates, that means there will be abnormal cell division, and that abnormal cell division is a sign of the cancer. So putting all the thing into a summary is that when the proto-oncogene, which are required for the normal cell division and differentiation, when they are mutated, they are converted into the oncogene, and then they are responsible for causing the abnormal cell division and differentiation, which is cancer. Another important gene that is known is the tumor suppressor genes. Now these tumor suppressor genes, they are actually the regulatory mechanisms of cell division, and they are actually preventing the abnormal cell growth. One of the important examples of the tumor suppressor gene is the P53 gene, and I have got a comparison of the normal P53 gene and a mutated P53 gene in this particular image. What happens is that when there is the P53 is in the normal condition, and there is a DNA damage because of any reason, and when there is damage to the DNA, what this P53 do is that the first thing is do is that it is going for the cell cycle arrest. So how the P53 arrests the cell cycle, I have a detailed video on this, and I'll share the link in the description so you can see the whole detail how the P53 is arresting the cell cycle. So when there is damage to the DNA, the P53, the first thing it do is that it is going for the cell cycle arrest. Then it is signaling the DNA repair mechanism to repair the DNA. And if the DNA that is repaired, the cell cycle, it can restart and it can go for the cell division. But if the DNA repair system, it signals that the damage is very severe and we are not able to repair the DNA, then what the P53 do is that it is going for the apoptosis, and that cell with the damaged DNA that is removed from the body. And when that is removed from the body, that means there will be no negative effect of that abnormal cell on the normal cell. Now, when the P53, it is in the mutated form, or you can simply say it is converted from the normal into the mutated form. And when there is a damage to the DNA, that means that the P53 will not be able to arrest the cell cycle. It will not be able to go for the DNA repair. It will not be able to go for the apoptosis. So the cell cycle will continue. And as the DNA is damaged, so if you are going for the cell division with the damaged DNA, there are chances for the cells to become cancerous. And when the cell become cancerous, that is going to negatively affect your body. So this is another important thing, that the tumor suppressor gene, if there is mutation, that can also be a cause of cancer. So the proto-oncogenes and the tumor suppressor gene, they are actually responsible for the normal cell division and the differentiation. But if there is problem in the tumor suppressor gene or the proto-oncogene, the end result is a cancer. Another important example is the Philadelphia chromosome, and this Philadelphia chromosome is one of the important example of the translocation. Now, the Philadelphia chromosome, sometimes known as the Philadelphia translocation, is a specific chromosomal abnormality that is associated with the chronic myelogenous leukemia, one of the types of the cancer. Now, how this Philadelphia chromosome, or how this chronic myelogenous leukemia, it occurs? This chronic myelogenous leukemia, or the Philadelphia chromosome, is a result of the translocation between the chromosome number 9 and the chromosome number 22. And this translocation between the chromosome number 9 and chromosome number 22, it actually involves two genes. One of the gene is present on the chromosome number 9, and that particular gene is known as the Abelson-Murin leukemia, or short that is known as the ABL1 gene. Now, the normal function of the ABL1 gene, that it is a proto-oncogene. Now you may have the idea what I'm talking about. If this is a proto-oncogene, that means that it is responsible for the normal cell division and differentiation. So the ABL proto-oncogene that encode a cytoplasmic and a nuclear protein tyrosine kinase, and this tyrosine kinase has been implicated in the process of the cell differentiation, the cell division, cell adhesion, and stress response. So if the ABL1 is present on the chromosome number 9 and it is in the proto-oncogene, that is required for the normal functioning of the cell. Another important gene that is present on the chromosome number 22, and that is known as the BCR gene, or the breakpoint cluster region gene. Now, if you talk about normal function, the function of the normal BCR gene product is not clear, although the BCR-ABL fusion protein has been extensively studied. And the BCR-ABL fusion protein is made when there is translocation between the chromosome number 9 and the chromosome number 22. As you can see over here, when you talk about the before translocation scenario, the ABL gene is present on the chromosome number 9. The BCR gene is present on the chromosome number 22. But after the translocation, as you can see, the ABL and the BCR gene that has been placed in vicinity of each other. And this short chromosome in which the BCR and the ABL gene that has been placed in close vicinity, this is known as the Philadelphia chromosome. And this is during this particular condition that you are getting the BCR-ABL fusion protein, because they are in close vicinity with each other and they are under the single promoter. Now, what is the function of this ABL-BCR fusion protein? The ABL gene expression, because the ABL gene that expresses a membrane-associated protein, a tyrosine kinase, as I've told you, the ABL-BCR transcript is also translated into a tyrosine kinase. What this means is that in both of the cases, whether the ABL gene is in the normal form or if that is in the fusion form with the BCR, in both of the cases, the protein product is a tyrosine kinase. But there is a difference between the normal tyrosine kinase coded by the ABL gene alone and the tyrosine kinase coded by the ABL-BCR transcript, or this fusion protein. Now, the activity of this normal tyrosine kinase that is controlled by the other molecules, by the cell cycle control mechanisms, but this mutant tyrosine kinase, which is coded by the ABL-BCR transcript, that result in the tyrosine kinase that is always on, or that is continuously activated. And if this ABL-BCR tyrosine kinase is continuously activated and it is always on, it results in unregulated cell division or cancer. In the normal form, when the tyrosine kinase, the ABL, it called the tyrosine kinase, and when the tyrosine kinase has performed its function, the control system of the cell cycle, it degrades this tyrosine kinase, and the function of this tyrosine kinase, when that is no more required, that has been eliminated. But the tyrosine coded by the ABL-BCR transcript, it do not respond to the cell cycle control system, and it is always on, and when it is always on, that is going to result in the unregulated cell division, which is known as the cancer. So if you like the video, please subscribe to my channel, hit the like button and share it with your friends, and we will continue the discussion in the next video.